learning is in our DNA itself. It's so natural that evolution has been using it for millions of years, if not longer. And Darwin didn't come up with something new when he looked at change and adaptation. He was simply the first human to point us towards the essence of the universe. Change has always taken place, but now it is tangible even within the shortest human-defined moment in time. Pantare, said Heraclitus, change is inevitable. Humans have always used instruments, but now our technology is at that stage where it can augment our body and mind. Therefore, we, as a species, are at the verge of a new learning era. For me, or in my view, the future of education for the next 25 years will make us telepathic, telekinetic, and connected through all of our network brains. No single human being is the same, which means that all of our learning journeys are different. At this point in time, we can use technology to assimilate and absorb a gazillion amounts of information. The only thing is, we need to adjust so that we can absorb it more rapidly and that the things that we do absorb are of high quality. Learning analytics, big data, and quantified self can help us to enhance these personal learning journeys. Now, for those who like a challenge, I got two challenges from which you can choose an assignment if you like to. The two options are either sharing a project for the future of education or provide an overview of a critical essay. Now, in terms of the project, I want you to link to three different projects or information sites that can work as a background for your project and also include short synopsis on why you think this is a good backdrop for your project. And then describe in 300 words what the goal of your project is. So how does it add to the future of education? And which critical steps do you need to take? You can compare it with a roadmap. Second option is to write a critical overview or a critical essay overview. So you provide 800-word essay in which you clearly reject this idea of future education that I have, either the telepathy, telekinesis, connected brain, whatever. And you share it as like a draft towards a real essay that you can publish later on. So now let's look at the quantified self, the qualified self, and the connected self. The quantified self. Let's start. We are now surrounded by smart objects. There are smart objects in our houses and even in wearable technologies which we carry along. In the smart houses, this makes life much easier. If we pick up the last box of milk, our refrigerator can send an automated message to our supermarket and new milk will be delivered the next day. For me, it means that with my wearable technologies, my diabetes is monitored, my glucose levels are monitored, and I can adjust much more easily. There are also more intimate, subcutaneous smart devices as well. For instance, the smart contact lenses, now being developed by Google, which also monitor medical conditions. And in cognitive science, there is a lot of work done to see what affects learning? So either which types of music or which types of environment or even in epigenetics. So I truly believe that with these latest developments, the quantified self will very easily move towards a telekinetic self. Because once these external devices become integrated in our own body, it will be easy enough to control all of these devices and all of the settings that we want to control with our mind. It's a bit like those pilots which direct a plane purely by thinking about it. So telekinesis will come more rapidly than we imagine. It's also very natural. Our brain has always used instruments to make things happen, to start actions. Telekinesis makes life much easier because we are left with more space to really think about stuff, to really use our mind for different reasons. Which brings us to the qualified self. The qualified self being the mind that is prepared for their own personal or professional interests. Now, MOOCs and SPOCs, specialized private online courses, deliver curated content which can be delivered either from experts in the field, just in time, and always authentic, like connected to the context of the learner itself. Now, self-regulated learning is of course also an essential tool in the future of education, and more research is done into self-regulated or self-directed or self-determined learning to see what triggers it. For instance, epigenetics, research into epigenetics, has shown that changing the environment has a profound effect on your learning capacities. Another aspect of the qualified self, or to improve the qualified self, is the connected internet. With all the technologies that are changing our world, it also means that the jobs are no longer the same. Jobs are constantly changing. So we also see a rise in professional schools. There are already a lot of MOOC-related professional schools out there, and to my estimate, it's going to keep on growing and become part of the future of education as well. One of those options is the connected self. This means not the connected self, it builds upon the connected self as we see it today, so information is distributed across people. But it brings us to the next step. If you look at learning from online content, that's information-based learning. But if you learn from peers, you have mentor-based learning. And those mentors have much more experience, have found ways to look at information gathering in a generic way. So they have certain qualities that will enhance learning overall. And this is where the telepathic challenge comes in, which I think is a more difficult challenge because it has a lot to do with our philosophical mindset, our willingness to trust people, and our willingness to share, which are all human traits that can be different from person to person. In my mind, if you are connected, if you look at the connected self, and you look at how information is gathered, you see a long iteration with a lot of assumptions and a lot of reflections that could be wrong. Because if I write an article, I start from my own mindset, write it down. I write it down in English, which isn't my native language. Then I put it on paper, so I use different jargon. Then I send it to the editors, who have their own idea of how you should write an article. They send out feedback. I adjust the article. Then it is published. Then you, for instance, can read it with your mindset, with your assumptions. You interpret the article and the evidence that I put forward. And then from there, you build your own concept, your own idea, which again is assimilating my research, but in a specific personal way, and then sent out again. Now, just imagine if we could circumvent all of these extras, and we just meet and we link minds up to a certain extent, and you would immediately know certain assumptions from my end, and I would feel certain assumptions from your end, which makes it easier to actually get to the core of the information and to the core of the knowledge. So, and then if you take us as people, and we walk through a crowd, and all of a sudden something in your mind says, hey, this person you wanted to know more about the latest diabetic technology, this person is actually working on it, connect. I would just ask, can I talk to you? and the other person would know why I want to talk to him or her. So that would make life or learning much easier. Learning is shifting from formal to informal, much more into the flow of learning. So intrinsic motivation, really complex learning or increasing the complexity of your own personal learning, provides a lot of nice, interesting results. Even if we look, if we only look at teenagers, we can see now outcomes that we never imagined possible before, just because everybody is more connected right now. For instance, teenagers across the world use YouTube videos to enhance their physical skills and to enhance their cognitive skills as well. If you look at three examples, just picking out three and not naming names, you can find the names if you click on the links. You have a 16-year-old who is building a cheap pancreatic cancer detector, or a 15-year-old who finds a correlation between star maps and Mayan cities, or a 10-year-old who looks at Instagram and unravels a security flaw in its programming. So these much quicker iterations of knowledge are happening right here, right now. Of course, reaching the quantified, qualified, connected self has a lot of consequences. First of all, we need to be able to collaborate across disciplines, and we need to do this in the technological fields as well as the non-technological fields. Then we also need to unravel the human brain further, because how does it work and why does it tick the way it does in different types of people? We also need to open up our technology and open up the way we react to technology. Let's say, for instance, biohacking. To take into account the complete contexts and then the results from these contexts in, again, different people. We also need to enhance our data openness and our willingness to share, which is quite a tough one. And of course, we need to build trust. Are we willing to live in a telepathic world? Because somebody is going to say, oh, you're a bore. I mean, people think it, but you don't say it. And vice versa, you're so hot while you're talking about something intellectual. In a telepathic world, all of these might just actually be said without actually coming out of the mouth. So there are a lot of things we need to work on. Nevertheless, it will enhance our learning. And personal learning needs to become more enabled. More diversified content, more opportunities, and again, a philosophical side of things must be monitored, because where do we want to go as a human species, but also as a holistic whole, as a planet? I surely want to contribute my part in it, so I'm actually investigating how people self-regulate their learning in the long run, using technologies. I want to hear what you are planning.